thank you once again, ladies and gentlemen, for bearing with us. And now it's time to delve into the next session, which is about the scope, potential, and opportunities in the PMS and AIF industry over the next decade. So moving on, we have with us Mr. Ashish Somaiya, CEO, White Oak Capital Management. Now at White Oak, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Ashish Somaiya is responsible for managing and growing its operations. He is an experienced professional and has proficiency in scaling up and managing relations across well-known AMCs like Motilal Oswal AMC and ICICI Prudential AMC. Mr. Somaiya, who has pursued Masters in Finance and Bachelors in Science, brings 2 decades of industry experience. Next, I'd like to introduce to all of you Mr. Vikas M. Sachdeva, the Chief Executive Officer of MK Investment Managers Limited. Mr. Sachdeva is an industry veteran with over 2 decades of experience. In the course of his career, he has held several influential and senior management positions across marquee financial service organizations. He has a broad range of interests across functions like sales, distribution, marketing, investment banking, product, and customer service. Warm welcome, Mr. Vikas M. Sachdeva. I'd also like to introduce you, ladies and gentlemen, to our next panelist, Mr. Bhautik Ambani, MD, Avendus Capital Alternate Strategy. Now, prior to joining Avendus, he was the director of Ambit Investment Advisors, where he was responsible for the marketing of the Ambit Alpha Fund, which was one of the largest hedge funds in India. He spent the last 13 years in the asset management and wealth management industry in India. So, Mr. Bhautik Ambani, welcome to you. Now, these panelists will discuss, ladies and gentlemen, the need and projected growth of alternates over the next decade. And this session will be moderated by Mr. Nimesh Mehta, who is the Director and Country Head of Sales and Products for ASK Investment Managers Limited. Mr. Mehta has more than 21 years of experience in industries ranging from NBFC, equities, asset management, and financial services. He's also an author of an international bestseller book on Amazon titled Sales Booster. With that, I'm now going to hand over the proceedings of this session to Mr. Nimesh Mehta. Sir, please.
Thank you, Aishwarya. Let me begin first by congratulating Kamal and the PMS AIF World Team for hosting the second successful PMS AIF and Summit Award function, although this time a virtual one. I attended a couple of sessions yesterday and even today morning. I must mention that each of the sessions provided a lot of insights and learning to me and also the audiences which we had. But most of the sessions were built around investing. Some discussed about the long-only investing and some discussed the long-short investing. This panel is a departure from what we have seen until now. As Aishwarya said, we're going to discuss on the need and the projected growth in the next decade. So we're going to split our presentation or a conversation in 2 parts. First, we'll discuss the need and then we'll deliberate the growth of the alternates. I'm told by the PMS AIF World Team that we have a lot of advisors and a lot of investors. So I'm going to wear the hat of an investor and advisor and I'm going to ask pointed questions to this esteemed panel. So let me get started. I had the privilege to work under Ashish at Motilal Oswal AMC and must mention I learned a lot from him. So Ashish, here is my first pointed. I am taking this privilege to ask you the first pointed question as an investor. Why do you think I as an investor need to have a long-only AIFs or a PMS when I already own enough and many long-only mutual funds?
Sure, Nimesh, pleasure to speak to you and to, you know, the co-panelists and all the esteemed guests at this PMS AIF summit. So, you know, you said 3-4 times the word pointed, you know, it's quite scary, quite scary, actually. But, you know, look, I think that the target audience or the risk return profile that we are trying to address by managing PMS or long-only AIFs is fairly different from what we aim to address by way of managing mutual funds. You know, as we are aware, mutual funds are mass retail vehicles, right? And the entire population theoretically can be a mutual fund investor because, you know, we are taking as little as 100 rupees, 500 rupees. And at the same time, we don't expect, you know, these investors to really understand the ins and outs of how fund management is actually performed. As a result of that, it's very important from a regulatory perspective and from an investor protection perspective, it's very important that mutual funds are fairly standard, straight jacketed, And as a result, they sometimes also end up being commoditized in nature. So just to give you a few examples, the regulator actually determines, you know, what is the investment universe, you know, what is large cap, what is mid cap, what is the definition of mid cap, where can the funds invest, you know, how much can you invest in a particular sector sometimes or in a particular stock, you know, what is the kind of charges, you know, what is the kind of distribution practices, how can you carry these funds. So many things about mutual funds, you know, it is perforce necessary that if we want the novice investor to feel comfortable, and if we want to achieve the highest aims of investor protection, then mutual funds have to be standardized and straitjacketed. And the amount of risk that they can take to target a particular return has to be really mellowed down. As opposed to that, when you look at PMS, for instance, it's my preferred mode of investing. The reason being that, first of all, in a PMS, what happens is that my portfolio as an investor is held in my demat account. You know, when you look at a mutual fund, it's managed as a pool. And as you'll appreciate that mutual funds have millions of investors on any given day, millions of investors are investing and millions are exiting. I always quote this example. If you look at March 2020, that was a disaster, right?
Yeah.
But there was 34,000 crores of redemption in March 2020. There was inflow also. There were some really smart cookies who were bottom fishing. But you know, where the inflow comes, where the outflow comes, it's not necessarily the same scheme or the same fund. The reality is that even in March 2020, there was 34,000 crore of outflow. So if you're a mutual fund manager, even in March 2020, you have to sell. And you will sell what is sellable. And in March 2020, you can only sell HDFC at 800 and Reliance at 900. You know, you can't be selling AU Bank at 200 bucks, correct? So in a mutual fund, there are issues with straitjacketing, commoditization. There are issues with managing flows, and those flows are subject to the sum total behavior of millions of retail investors. Now, that's not how a PMS works. In a PMS, your portfolio is in your demat account. My portfolio is in my demat account. If you are a smart cookie on 23rd March, you will be giving money to your PMS manager. And if I'm panicking, I might be withdrawing. Now, my withdrawing is funded by selling the stocks in my demat. And in your demat, actually, there may be a credit entry on the very same day. Plus, if you see, you know, fees and so many other things, PMS has a lot of flexibility. We can have performance-linked fees. We can have alpha-linked fees. Many, many. Lastly, I would say that PMS is probably the most transparent vehicle. It is so transparent that it needs very mature investors, you know, because I always say that PMS is like performing surgery without anesthesia. You can see literally every transaction and every trade. You can literally see every hisab of every cost. So it is so transparent that it calls for some serious amount of maturity, because otherwise as an investor, you can get lost. Ye bhav pe ye kyun kharida, ye kyun becha, you know, all these kind of things. AIF, I think, is best of both worlds, you know, because it has the operational and investment latitude of a PMS, but it has the, cuteness of the mutual fund in terms of operations. So that's how I would put it. I would sum up by saying my favorite vehicle is a PMS. That's how I invest personally. Rest is up to, you know, investors' return, risk return expectations.
So do I in terms of PMS. I have my family money in the PMS investing. Because you have built, you know, you've transitioned from building mutual fund business to, you know, building PMS only on the last couple of years. And therefore, this same question to you, that why have you moved, and, you know, what's in it for the PMS versus long only mutual funds? Your thoughts on the same.
Well, it's interesting. I was just listening very intently to Ashish when he was describing the word alternates in terms of this thing. Way back in 98-99, I joined the mutual fund industry in 95-96. At that point of time, mutual funds were alternates. You know, because the conventional investment avenue at that point of time were your quintessential FDs, which were giving 15, 16, 17% rates of interest, and you really didn't need to look anywhere else. And the only mutual funds in existence at that point of time were your UTI Master Gains and Morgan Stanley's of the world, which were closed-ended funds. You know, so open-end mutual funds were a very, very different line of thinking. And today now we've moved to describing alternates as those which are probably not mutual funds. You know, it's something which is very heartening. I think a few things which will drive PMSs, and I'm probably going to extrapolate a few of Ashish's points. One is from an industry point of view, I believe this is an idea whose time has come. If you realize, if you go back in history and you see 99-2000 was the time when the equity segment in mutual funds actually took off. That is because the government of India had introduced, the finance minister had introduced Section 54 EAEB as avenues where you could invest in equity to avail of certain tax benefits. Today, if you see in a very different sort of a way, mutual funds themselves, like Ashish said, are unable to elbow their way through in terms of providing much better returns. It's a safe avenue, it's for a retail investor. But if you really want alpha, you have to come to alternates. If you want beta, you go to ETFs. Mutual funds are going to be, just to borrow a phrase, an FD plus vehicle, which is very good for the retail investor. But for the savvy HNI investor, I think he would move towards alternates. And again, from a customer point of view, I just like to use the word emotional engagement. Ashish did talk about a DMAT account and transparency and maturity. I'd like to sum it all up by saying emotional engagement. You know, it's the difference between holding actual currency and digital currency. An actual currency, you can feel a note in your hand. A digital currency is just a line. It's a number in your passbook, right? It's a number in your account. Similarly, a mutual fund is an NAV. He doesn't realize what the constituents behind an NAV is, you know, at least till the end of the month. But in a PMS sort of a platform, every stock which is debited or credited to his account, he gets a message. Again, AIF, I think what excites me about AIF, one is obviously the ease of operating an AIF. But I think if you just move beyond long-only AIFs, I think the scope is phenomenal for asset managers to actually innovate and come with their ideas to an extremely mature audience. I mean, the fact that you have to invest a minimum of 1 crore probably equates yourself to the fact that you understand the markets and the risk much better than anybody else. So to sum up, I think this is an idea whose time has come. I think the bottom line is when you start seeing high net worth individual money moving from one end of the spectrum to the other, this is the most savviest segment. And it has moved exponentially to alternates in the last 12 to 18 months in particular. So that's pretty much my
view. You said an idea whose time has come, and I'll completely agree with that. Let me bring in Bhautik. Bhautik, your firm, Avendus, runs one of the largest long-short funds in the country. I want you to, again, sorry, I'm using the pointed word, you know, Ashish said not to use that very strong okay. word, but I'm just
Ashish was very pointed about it.
You can.
As an investor,
feel free.
Why should I need to have a long-short fund in the alternate? And as an investor, why should I need to have a long-short fund in my portfolio?
Sure. So I think, Dimesh, there are multiple reasons why, you know, one needs to look at alternates versus traditionals, right? And one of them is, you know, what Vikas mentioned is about this whole debate about beta versus alpha. Let me focus on one aspect, which is diversification, right? Now, typically, historically, what we've done is that we have diversified across equity, debt, even other asset classes. And the basic reason to diversify is that you need an asset class which is either a lowly correlated or it has negative correlation, right? Now think about this fact. Post the financial crisis of 2008, what has changed is that the correlation across asset classes have only increased. Now with that happening, think about the fact today. Can you diversify between equity and debt? Right? Think about it today that, you know, at index at 50,000 on Sensex and interest rates at 3-4%, if you diversify between debt and equity, if markets go down from here, and if you are diversifying into debt, and if interest rates go from up from here, you're going to lose money from both sides, right? So the point here is that, can you diversify between traditional asset classes? The answer is no. And the only way you can diversify is by going into alternates, because alternates are the ones which give you a platform which can actually give you low correlation or negative correlation, and which gives you the true diversification. And I think classic example is if you look at last year when the markets fell, and you know what Ashish spoke about, when markets fell, you know, more than 30% last year in COVID around March. Look at the returns of mutual funds, look at the returns of PMSs, and look at the returns of long short AIFs. You're going to see a vast difference. There are multiple PMS managers who have outperformed the market by a huge margin, which you will not find with even with 5% mutual funds, right? Similarly, for example, long short funds outperform the markets considerably. There are multiple examples of mutual funds, including AIFs, long short funds, including ours, which considerably outperform the market, which would have just not been possible for any traditional asset class to do. So I think if somebody wants to diversify in a portfolio in today's market scenario, they need alternates. And I think alternates complement a traditional portfolio. That's the way I look at it.
I take the point of diversification from your opening comment. Gentlemen, you know, I did a quick survey from with all the advisors and distributors distributing alternates, and I asked them what the percentage of their clients' money is in alternates. So on one side, I saw the private wealth having 40-50% or slightly around that range. The other side, the distributor advisors, has roughly about only 10-15%. And that, you know, brings me that, you know, the investor does not have an, or an advisor does not give a higher allocation to alternates. So Vikas, if you can step in here and, you know, convince the advisors on the and the audience out here as to why they should increase the weightage of the alternates in the client's allocation. Vikas, you there? Yeah, because you're muted. Can't hear you. Sankalpo, can you just check? What we'll do is that by the time you know Vikas gets back, maybe Ashish, if I can, you know, ask you to answer that.
And yeah, also, sure.
Yeah, please.
So I think, see, one thing very clearly is that different advisors or intermediaries would have different profiles of clients. But let's assume that the clients have the risk appetite and the ability. And, you know, like Bhautik mentioned, even the maturity or the awareness to, you know, invest in, say, the opportunities which are addressed by these PMS AIFs or alternates broadly as a category. So one clearly depends on the client profile and the need to educate clients, you know, because what I've seen is that when it comes to PMS or AIF, for instance, there's fair amount of baggage, because if you go back 15, 20 years, you know, before there are, you know, now if you see whether it is all the, you know, if you see here, there is ASK, Motilal Oswal, or, you know, say now my firm and many other firms which we see here, they're established players now for many, many years. But if you go back 15, 20 years, the latitude that is available for investment in PMS, let's admit, in some cases we have seen in the industry that it was misused, you know, very high charges, very aggressive investment, very concentrated positions. So these kind of things have happened, and there is some amount of baggage. I think in the last few years, the fabulous job that the regulator has done is that just like mutual funds have been more and more regulated, even for AIFs and PMS, the framework has been considerably strengthened. So without killing the investment latitude, at least some amount of standardization of how the money will be managed, what kind of charges, transparency. And like we've heard a couple of times, it is actually the most transparent. Third thing, I think why advisors should really look at it is because of the wide ranging possibilities on fees and expenses. Now, look, the first and most simple thing, in the recent times, we have seen that a lot of mutual funds haven't been able to outperform the index, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, a simple thing that a PMS can do is to, you know, charge the fixed fee, which is just like an index fund, and charge a variable fee, which is linked to the alpha. You know, now these kind of things can be done a PMS or a AIF, but this just, it's just not possible when it comes to mutual funds. What do mutual funds have in terms of pricing? There's a direct plan and a regular plan, right? Whereas when it comes to PMS and AIF, you have the ability to devise the fee depending on what suits the advisor and the customer. So multitude of reasons why they should adapt to this. That's what I would say.
I'll still go on and ask you furthermore. There's another question which was there. In the perception of an investor is there, the risk management is much better in a mutual funds. Yeah. And therefore I'm, you know, okay. And therefore one of the reasons I feel that they want or don't want. Can you, with your experience, suggest that how is risk managed on alternates as well, please?
See, I think it's not lack of risk management. Investors and advisors should know that a PMS and an AIF by design is meant to take more latitude. The moment you get into a PMS or an AIF, you're signing up for slightly more investment latitude. You are the one who is telling the manager that I've come to you because I could have gone to a mutual fund, which does not have as much investment latitude as you will probably be allowed to take. So you are actually subscribing to it. And that latitude should ultimately produce, you know, over a long period of time, that latitude should produce better outcomes. If nothing, at least the latitude should be used to make the costs slightly more productive, like, you know, be alpha linked or whichever way that you think of it. And the last thing which I would say is that it doesn't mean that the PMSs and AIFs don't have risk management. For example, the kind of products that Bhautik and his team manage, I mean, I'm sure that they are not long only, they are long short. They have different ways of controlling risk. Even within long only products in PMS and AIF, of course, we use multiple techniques. Like, for example, one of the things at White Oak, which we do, is to consistently have a balanced portfolio. So we balance our portfolio for multiple macros, you know, whether it is exchange rates, oil prices, commodity prices, the stock market cycle by way of the beta itself. So there are multiple mechanisms which are anyway used. But long story short, what I would say is that an investor should know that you're signed up for this and you must read what all this entails.
Sure. Thanks. Wonderful. Bhautik, let me combine two questions. Is taxation a deterrent for a long short fund to be not a part of the advisor's portfolio or an investor portfolio? And then you can build on in terms of how and convince the advisor out here that why there's a need to have this in the client's portfolio, please.
Sure. So let me kind of try and first address the part about, you know, this whole thing about how much people are allocating to alternatives.
Yes.
I think the biggest difference that I see is that why treat alternates as alternates? Right? Like, alternates is not an homogeneous set. Right? It's not like gold, saying that gold is one asset class and you allocate 5% to it. Alternates is not an homogeneous set. Alternates have, you know, different risk return profiles, and there are multiple products there. It's not like you say that I want to allocate a certain percentage of mutual funds. You will say that within mutual funds, I allocate a certain percentage to equity, certain percentage to debt. Within equities, I'll do large, mid, small, growth, value, different things, right? Similarly, in alternates is not one homogeneous set. You can't look at that as one percentage allocation. So let me kind of give you an example. Why can't you actually relate every alternate product that is available to the traditional asset class that you have? For example, when you're looking at equity allocation, you look at PMS, mutual funds, private equity funds together. Why do you have to look at mutual funds as traditional? And why do you have to look at PMS and private equity as separate? Yeah. Similarly, when you're doing a fixed income allocation, you have to think about the fact that there are many alternate products which actually give you a similar risk return profile. Like one of the products that we run, which is an absolute return strategy, it fits in very well as a fixed income allocation client portfolio. And all the monies that we have from clients, that's the way they've allocated in their portfolios too, right? And when they ask us this question, what percentage do we allocate? My simple to answer to them is that within your fixed income allocation, you look at this product, where does it fit from a risk return profile? And you allocate a certain percentage there. It's not about saying that I have a certain allocation to alternates out of my entire kitty, and I'll allocate a percentage of that. So I think people need to start thinking of alternates as mainstream rather than calling it alternates.
Sure.
Right. That's the most important thing. To your second point around taxation, so that's very close to our heart, because, you know, we actually come from an industry which deals a lot in derivatives, and it's something that we've been fighting for years now.
Yeah.
Right. Taxation. And the reason we've been fighting is that, you know, globally, when you look at alternates or when you look at hedge funds, you have parity. Whether it's a hedge fund, whether it's a long-only mutual fund, whether it's a managed account, you have parity on taxation, right? You don't have disparity saying that mutual funds are taxed in X way and something else is taxed in a Y, or something else is in, you know, in something else, right? So I think that parity exists globally, and that's exactly what we've been asking for out here. Having said that, I think the industry has grown tremendously in the last 7 years, right? So for example, if you look at the AIF regulations, they only came in 2012. And from since then to now, there are hundreds of players who got into alternates, whether it's long only, whether it's long short, there are multiple people who've gone into this space. The industry has grown at a pace which is way faster than, you know, you look at any traditional asset class or any traditional platform that you see today. And that's despite the taxation disadvantage that the industry has in some of the products, right? So I think that has happened.
Yeah.
But the fact remains that if there is parity around taxation, I think what you've seen today is only the tip of the iceberg. I think the industry can grow many fold from here. For example, if you have 10,000 crores in long short funds, if there is parity on taxation, I think within a year, what we've achieved in 7 years, this can easily grow by 5 or 10 times.
I'm sure
that it has.
Yeah, you are almost getting to the growth side of our conversation. But let me ask, you know, the last question to this panel, and I'll just check if Vikas is also back. And anybody can take this. Every conversation ends up with saying that, I'll put it in, you know, Hindi in term of there, itni fees kyun hai bhai? Matlab, you know, why should I pay more fees in a PMS and alternates? And, you know, maybe Ashish can chip in, or anyone who wants to chip in first, because the conversation gets stuck at the end. Okay, everything is good. But, you know, as I said, I'm going to ask an investor, as an investor, why are the, you know, fees, and how can you explain me that fees is not a deterrent, or fees should not be considered? Over to you, Ashish, or anyone.
Yeah, so I'll chip in and hand over to Vikas. See, I think it's a misnomer. It's not true that, in fact, I had the experience of running, which is very rare or very unique, that I used to run a PMS and mutual fund, both were equal in size, you know, in terms of the corpus. And practically what I saw was that weighted average fee, the gross fee charged, weighted average gross fee charged on the PMS was actually lower than the weighted average gross fee charged on the total mutual fund.
That's interesting.
The reason is very simple, because in a PMS, you know, depending on the size of the application, the fees are calibrated, right? Yeah. In a mutual fund, let's be very clear. In a mutual fund, if I invest 10 lakh rupees and you invest 1 crore rupees, we both are told that we are going to pay 2%. But you are paying 10 times of what I paid, correct? In a PMS, it doesn't work that way. You know very well that the 10 lakh rupee, or now say 50 lakh rupee, the fee of 50 lakhs versus the fee of 5 crores will be different. I know it will not be 1/10, yeah, but at least there is a sliding scale, number one. Number two is that, you know, nowadays I have seen fee structures in the industry which are 0% fixed fee and some percentage of alpha and some percentage over a hurdle, and, you know, all kinds of innovation which are happening. For example, when at Whiteoak we started charging only on the alpha, that also is a different type of innovation where we are sticking our neck out and saying that we'll charge a fee. Bulk of the fee will be when we outperform the benchmark. So I think some of these things which say that, you know, alternates always have high, I think they are lazy explanation. I think one needs to get into the detailing. But my practical experience was that, that feeling is not borne out with data. It's only a feeling.
That's a very important point, and that could be music to the ears of investors, the weighted gross fees charged in a PMS versus mutual fund. Because if you are back, and if you just want a quick...
Can you hear me? Nimish, can you hear me? Because I thought you were the...
Very nice.
Okay, great.
An increase in allocation.
So I'm also going to just use a phrase, taking the liberty of using a phrase when we compare, PMS or AIF to other investment avenues. Ki achhi cheez aur sasti cheez mein fark hota hai. You know, so the value that you get when you invest in a customized sort of a vehicle like PMS or in a smarter vehicle like AIF, there is a certain amount of understanding you need to have in terms of the value you get versus the fees you pay. But even on that, and I'm just going to extrapolate one point here, the number of people in the PMS, the number of players in the PMS industry are over 400 today. Okay, it's a highly competitive industry. Any fund manager and any business development person worth his salt today is looking at moving to the PMS / AIF side simply because there is a little bit of leeway there to operate. That also means that the investor has a lot of choice. He is not stuck with something which is a regulator defined expense ratio, which he has to go in for irrespective of, whether he wants it or not. So to that extent, I think you will always find that wherever there is hyper competition, on a gross level, the fees tend to come down. We should not mistake the woods for the trees and look at a few examples or try to extrapolate that. I also just want to talk about one aspect which I really enjoyed when Bhautik brought it up, from the point of view of an investor. You talked about taxation, and yes, I think the industry has a point of view in terms of taxation. But if you really look at the investor segment we go to, okay, this investor segment beyond a point understands taxation much better than most of the people. So they know what sets off against what, and they will be able to plan their taxation much better. What they're looking at is more of gross returns rather than net returns at the end of the day, because they know how to plan their taxation very, very well. So I think this is an investment avenue now, which is checking all the boxes, and the savvy segment has already started moving towards it. And I think, the time has come. You will see a quantum jump in terms of the amount of money moving to alternates. And I'm going to use the word alternates till the time it becomes mainstream. Sorry about it. This is the way it is. But I completely agree with what he said.
Wonderful. So both of you have just given me the platform to move to the second part of our conversation. And I think you've given enough, gentlemen, a little conviction and confidence to have more of alternates in our portfolio. And as we move, let me start with Vikas first. Because, you know, the PMS industry has grown 18% in the last 5 years, from 70,000 crores to almost 1.63 lakh crores. I'm excluding the EPA for money. What do you think has led to this growth over the last 5 years? And what can we expect going forward?
I think quite a bit of this has been discussed by my panelists earlier, but I'll just like to give you a sort of a framework in terms of how this industry might grow. I think any industry in its inflection point has two parts. One is perceptibility and the other is adaptability. Yes. You started off, Nimish, in the initial stages talking about the perception which is there in terms of PMSs. And I think I'd like to hark back again to mutual funds. This was exactly the problem with mutual funds 20 years ago, right? And if you really see the trigger, the inflection point for the mutual fund industry came in a few years ago when they started this mutual fund SAHI campaign. You know, before that, I mean, it was going wrong, but it grew tangentially and exponentially after that campaign hit. So perception is reality in the absence of communication. Now that more and more people are starting to look at alternates because they've already experienced mutual funds, I think as more and more people understand it and try to look at the subtle nuances in terms of how it can add value, you are going to see a lot more migration happening here. The other one is adaptability. A lot of, I think one should give the mutual fund industry the credit for making it very simple to invest. Yeah. A lot of people underestimate the convenience part of it in terms of investing. And I think Ashish alluded to it when he talked about AIF in terms of it being having the cuteness of a mutual fund in a way. Ashish, I'm just borrowing that term from what he said. I think it was more in terms of how convenient it is to invest in a mutual fund, right? A PMS is still struggling a little bit in terms of onboarding, but not as much. So I think once the adaptability starts getting better and better and digitization is helping there, you will find that the comfort more than the conviction with alternatives like PMS and AIF will start going up dramatically. So I think this is, if you just go back in history and look at the framework, you are at the tipping point now in terms of growth of the alternate industry.
Great. Perceptibility, adaptability, I take care. Let me bring in Ashish here. One set of advisors feel, the new regulations, now the ticket size has gone from 25 to 50 lakhs. I think the growth in PMS is going to be maybe a single digit or lower than that. That's what, again, people believe because the ticket size has gone up. Any thoughts and will that be a deterrent to the growth of the industry?
You know, it's quite illogical because if we ask everybody, you know, they refer to these quotes that in the next few years, 50,000 Sensex will become 1 lakh. Then they say that we should invest only in small cap and mid cap. Then they say that there'll be a lot of wealth creation. There'll be a lot of entrepreneurial activity. This sector and that sector and everything will take off. India has a great middle class. We say all these things and then we say that we'll not find enough people who have 50 lakh rupees. So very illogical. I don't think that never comes to my mind really. The point is that there was a time when PMS used to be minimum 5 lakhs, then it became 25 lakhs, then it became 50 lakhs. So yes, you know, from an investor's perspective, it becomes a slightly higher commitment to begin with, which I respect and I appreciate because everybody is very careful and they should be careful. But I don't think that just because the minimums are 50 lakhs or a crore, that will, just squeeze the number of participants in the industry. I actually don't believe in that because if there is growth, then that growth reflects in every facet of the economy and its participants.
So, Ashish, for what I know, is you're an avid reader and observer of what's happened in global markets and trends. Question to you is, how do the alternates growth stack up in a developed economy or USA? And can we take some cues and, I will use what Vikas said. When will it become a mainstream kind of a platform in India?
See, it is becoming mainstream. Okay, look, one thing we should be clear that in the US, the term alternates is used for a much wider range of like here we are talking more about PMS and AIF and long only, long short, etc. In reality, even REITs are part of AIF, right? And then there are part of alternates, and you know, then there are multiple private equity, and there are multiple other types of products. But in fact, there was this McKinsey study which came a couple of years back, which clearly said that in the US, for instance, for every $100 which is there invested in mutual funds, there's more than $50 invested in alternates. It's reasonably mainstream. Now, what are those comparable numbers in India? If you see just equity, since we've been talking more equity, if you just see equity, the equity mutual fund industry after removing the EPFO money and all, let's say equity mutual fund industry is about 11 lakh crore, 10 and a half, 11, somewhere in that vicinity, right? As compared to that, our PMS industry must be now say what, 1,75,000 crores. And if you put the long only and CAC 3 AIFs, they must be another lakh plus. So it's already a stable market with nearly 3 lakh crores invested. It's not small by any means anymore, right? When we were working together in Motilal Oswal, you remember, the entire PMS was 10,000 crores. That 10,000 crore we are talking about now, 1,75,000 crore. So let's not forget that PMS industry has already grown faster than the mutual fund industry, because at that time, mutual fund industry was already 1,75,000 to 2 lakh crores.
Absolutely.
So in the time when that 1,75,000 to 11.5, the PMS has gone from 10,000 to 1,75,000. So it's already growing rapidly. And if you just take Western trends, then there is, even more longer runway.
Super. Great. Let me bring Bhautik here. Bhautik, and AIFs have grown like stupendously, like a 68% over the last, from a 35,000 crores of market to be more than 4 lakh crore. What do you think has led to this kind of growth in the AIFs, and what could be the growth going forward according to you?
So I think, in terms of AIFs, the growth that we've seen in the past has obviously been great. And the reason is very simple. I think the segment which is investing, whether in an AIF or a PMS, are high net worth individuals. They are the so-called smart investors who know that if they see value, they're going to invest in something. If they don't see value, they're not going to invest there, right? And obviously they've seen value in alternate investment funds, and exactly that's the reason. Compared to some of the other asset classes, they put in more monies here compared to some of the other asset classes, right? And I think that's only going to grow further. And the reason is very simple. Till now, the kind of innovation that we've seen in products is still nothing compared to what we've seen globally. There is lots more to do here, right? I mean, like if you look at globally, hedge funds are $3 trillion, right? Which is primarily including long short funds. The $3 trillion that I'm talking about, right? Now, compared to that $3 trillion, long short in India is less than $2 billion today, right? So there is a long way to go. In fact, one of the biggest space, which is a large component of the $3 trillion globally, is quant funds. We barely have any monies in quant funds in India.
Yeah.
Right? So I think there is a lot more innovation which is going to happen in this space. And I strongly believe that alternates are going to become more and more mainstream. We are only looking at numbers, what Ashish mentioned, what Vikas mentioned. These numbers are growing at a much faster pace compared to what you see in other asset classes. And I think going forward, people are going to look for places where they're going to get alpha, right? Beyond a point, people are not going to pay for beta.
Yeah.
Right? And that's what we're seeing globally as well. People are not ready to pay for beta. That's the reason, people are just moving to ETFs. Right? And that's a similar trend that we're seeing in India as well. Look at the number of mutual funds that had ETFs a few years back to now. I think every fund house has ETFs. In fact, the new thing which is happening is smart beta,
yeah,
where there is innovation in the ETF world itself. So I think a lot more will happen here. And people like the Western world, I think the mutual funds are going to find it difficult to try and generate alpha, which was relatively easier, in the earlier days.
Yes.
With that happening, I think you will see alternates or mainstream also.
Fabulous. I'm taking what Ashish said. It's already a mainstream now. And from what the growth is there, maybe we're just coming to the end, and maybe last question to Vikas, maybe. Vikas, what I'm hearing from the 40 minutes conversation is that a lot of education is required, a lot of understanding, a lot of misconception, perception, both on the advisor side. Is there, why don't we have a body on the alternates, like we have in a mutual fund side? Any thoughts? Because you're very passionate about it, and anything we can do around it, Your quick last thoughts on this, please.
So I think I speak for all three of us, that yes, of course, a body is required. And I think probably this is a trigger for us to just go back to the drawing table and look at it. But you just mentioned something about the growth of the industry. I think one of the reasons why this industry will grow, apart from whatever has just been mentioned by my co-panelists, is the amount of attention it is getting from the distribution and advisor fraternity. What we talk about at a panel level, I think, is already being understood by the distributor and advisor committee, and that is also being communicated. And if you see, the whole fulcrum of the mutual fund industry was the fact that the distributor and advisor committee adopted it in droves. So I think that is also going to happen here. My personal belief is, in terms of the alternate mainstream, if I can coin that term post this discussion, there is a bullet train coming. Okay. And while SEBI is trying to make it more and more transparent and better from what it was, I think the attempt should not be to mutual fundize the industry. Okay. And from that point of view, we will need to have an association. This is a different experience for the investor. This is a far better experience for the investor, at least the sophisticated investor. And I think the onus is on us now as an industry to get our hands together and start communicating with the regulator much more effectively.
Fabulous, fabulous. And on that note, maybe just we about 1 minute to go for our panel to get over. Let me ask each one of you a quick, crystal ball gazing question. And so let's suppose if we meet in February 2031 again on a PMS AIF world platform, what do you think the PMS industry would be today from 1.63 lakhs to what you can either say in a percentage or an absolute number? Because Ashish, and then maybe Bhautik.
Very, very difficult to put a number to it, but I would definitely say that it would be tens of times in terms of volume. Look, the reason is because we've still not scratched the institutional market. There's absolutely zero institutional, typically globally, there is giving separately managed accounts or advisory mandates to PMS managers is very, very common, right? We have practically zilch in terms of any institutional interest at this point in time. So that is bound to explode in a big way. Like we said, we are anyway expecting that the number of high net worth investors would definitely rise multifold.
Sure.
So I think that this is an industry which has barely even started. These are early days. And in the early days, we should not get carried away by 10,000 crore becoming 1,75,000 crore, because early days, it will always be multiplicative in nature. But ultimately, if you're saying 10 years from now, my sense would be humongous scale.
Wow. Anybody, Bhautik, want to add something, or there we can just close it?
I completely concur with what Ashish is saying. And, it's difficult to fathom a number today, because we're nowhere close to what it should be.
My role was to make you uncomfortable, and therefore I did that to the end. And the whole intention,
I can add to what is being said, having seen the growth of the mutual fund industry, way back in 96, if you would have told me in 2021, this would have been the size of the mutual fund industry, I would have laughed my guts off. Okay. Even in 2010, if you would have told me that this is going to be the size of the mutual fund industry, I would have still laughed. Maybe a little less convincingly, but I would have still laughed. So I think the sky is the limit. And, trying to peg a...
So the trick is to keep laughing.
Limit your imagination. Sorry?
The trick is to keep laughing, is it?
Keep smiling all the way to the bank for sure. On that note, I think, in 10 years from now, I hope to have retired early by putting in all my money in mainstream investment avenues and having made a lot more money and come in as an investor and talk to you in 2031.
By saying that, you're going to ensure that, a lot of wealth guys are going to reach out to you tomorrow morning or today itself. Money, but I like what you said, the bullet train, the inflection point. Ashish shared about mainstream, and I think sometimes mind cannot conceive the growth, like what you said, in the last quarter, last 10 years we've seen there, because geometric progression mind cannot conceive it. I think we're going to see at an inflection the growth which is not acceptable mind. And on that note, I would just like to thank each one of you for your comments, and thank you for guiding us all through the day. I would like to end the panel by wishing all the PMS and AIF managers best wishes for the awards coming up in a couple of hours. good luck to all, and over to Aishwarya and the PMS Herald.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mehta, for weaving this beautiful story so well, and for all the eminent panelists to also guide us and look at the years to come with more perspective. Thank you very much, Mr. Mehta, and all our panelists. Ladies and gentlemen, the next session is about real estate. But again, like I always take a 2 minutes break to get all the speakers lined up. I'm going to do the same now. The panelists are Mr. Balaji Rao, Mr. Harish Nair, Mr. Ashwin Chadha, and we're going to be here with us very, very shortly. I'm going to request all of you, Mr. Ashwin Chadha is actually going to be moderating this next session, which is going to be very impactful. Please give us just 2 minutes and we'll get the session started. Thank you very much.